Okay, I think we'll start. And we'll start with the questions that several of you had. And let me tell you, it was clear what the best part of last lecture was, because several people commented about it. Who knows? Exactly. I had break equal good. Then I have thanks for bringing the breaks back. And there was similar ones. Okay. You're welcome. At 10:25, anybody wants to raise their hand? Oh, man. Okay. Okay. One person says, I'm pretty salty about my grade at the moment. I do want to encourage you to learn as much as possible. And so for that reason, I haven't figured out exactly what I'm going to do. But there's a midterm, which I don't remember. It's 30% of your grade, and the final, which is 35% of the grade. I will do something where I will look at the final, and if you did better on the final than on the midterm, it will be counted more. I don't exactly know what the formula is, but that should motivate you for understanding the material. Okay? Okay? It was nice to hear about the Kinesin properties. I would like to have a homework problem on it. That is amazing. So thank you to that person. And I'll give you a homework problem on it. How do attendance points work? Basically, I don't know, remember it's 5 or 10% of your grade. If you're here, you'll get credit for it. If you're not, you won't. How do we know the noise is the square root of n? That's a good question. And I'm not sure that I can give you a good answer. Yeah. Okay. Oh, another person enjoyed the break. How does n relate to I? N is the number of photons that the object is putting out. It's sometimes used as n, sometimes used as the intensity. It's the same thing. Okay. There was also a number of questions about rods and cones and how your eye works. If we have time in the course, we will go over how your eye works, the rods and the cones. But for now, let me ask the question. How many photons can your eye see? Like if there's a star up there and it's getting, dimmer and dimmer and dimmer. Can you see a single photon? Yes? These people are very confident. How many people think the answer is maybe? Okay. How many think the answer is no? There's no. Okay. Well, it turns out the answer is maybe. Which is pretty amazing. that were right at the limit that we can see a single photon hitting your eye. It's amazing. Okay. Okay, so today we're going to continue with the subject. Of fluorescence, and in particular using a microscope and how to image it, and in particular how you can see few things, that is, you can see with very good sensitivity. Well, you can also see with very good spatial resolution, as in the object is here versus the object is here. What is the limit of which we can see the spatial accuracy, when something goes over here versus over here? Also, what is the spatial resolution? That is, when you have, for example, two molecules that are both emitting, can you tell that they're emitting at this distance and then at this distance? Is there any limit to what the distance is? And I should mention that there was the Nobel Prize given out this year in, I think it was chemistry, which is for super resolution microscopy. So excuse me?
Last year.
Well, okay. I guess it's right, formally 2014. I stand corrected. So, in general, I should say that the limit of the resolution, that is, can you tell that things are how far apart they are, has for 400 or 500 years since the invention of the microscope, the figure of merit is lambda over 2, where lambda is the wavelength that the fluorophore, whatever, is emitting. Which is, lambda is typically, let's say, 500, 600 nanometers. So lambda divided by 2 is about 250, 300 nanometers. And so that has been, it's called the diffraction limit of light. It's ruled for 400 or 500 years. Nowadays, within the last 15 years or so, we can not only tell if there are 250 nanometers apart, but down to a few nanometers. And that has had enormous implications. Okay, and the fluorescence is basically a way of getting great sensitivity and resolution. And we talked about first not via fluorescence, but simply absorbance. And there you had a light here shining on your image, and then you have your detector here, and notice if you don't have your object here, there's plenty of light going through, right? And so you get a signal without any sample there. That's inherently a bad way of doing things. It's not a bad way, it's just not very good in terms of seeing very small amounts. Now, if you do a dark field microscopy, like fluorescence, you come in with light, let's say blue light. Some fraction of that blue light is absorbed and it fluoresces. Sorry. And it fluoresces. In general, it fluoresces in what color? So in green, shown in here. In general, this is called what is the difference between the excitation light and the emission light? That is called the Stokes shift. Typically, it's 10 or 50 nanometers or so. Nevertheless, so it's green and it comes through this dichroic mirror, which reflects the blue light but transmits the green light, and then comes into your electronic detector or into your eye. And the thing to notice about that is if you do not have a fluorescent object, you get nothing. You'll see absolutely zero. It's only if you have some fluorescent object that you'll actually get a signal. Okay, so what we've done, is the important point is the signal to noise. More signal, you can see it. More noise, it's harder to see the signal from the noise. And then when the signal is about equal to the noise, it's hard to tell if there's anything there. The noise comes from two sources. One is just background, and the other comes from fluctuation in the signal. There is an inherent fluctuations in the signal, such that you know, your signal, or really your signal to background probably looks like this. This may be your background. You subtract it off, and you see this. But still, there is a fluctuation in this signal that corresponds to the square root of n, or n, let's say n sub s. Plus n sub b. And you can subtract off n sub b, and you get here. But you always have the fluctuation. And the fluctuation goes like the square root of n. Okay, so the signal to noise is then the signal, which is n photons, or n sub s, divided by the square root of n at best. So that means the signal to noise goes at itself as the square root of n. Okay, so what about if you have something really bright like the sun? The signal is a lot. Is the noise a lot too? Well, why is it, I see many of you going like this. Why is the noise a lot? That's right. So that the signal is a lot, but there's a lot of noise. Why can you see it? Is the signal to noise high? Yes. In fact, the signal to noise is going like the square root of n. Therefore, what about, can you measure a small fluctuation, like there's another star right nearby? No, you can't, because you have the n of the sun plus the n of the star. That difference is much less than the noise, where the noise goes like the square root of n sun plus n star. And unless the n star is big enough, you don't see it. So the real trick is you want to subtract off or eliminate the sources of background. So this method tells why absorbance is sort of a lousy way to go. Because you have a signal there, but you have a very light background. Okay, and a way to get very good signal to noise is with a fluorophore, where you come in with, let's say, blue light, and it emits at green light, and then you look at only the reflected light, and you can do that because you can spectrally filter. That is, you can filter out the blue light. Oops. There. You can filter out any of the blue light, and you only see the green. Okay. Most objects don't fluoresce, which is why the absorbance technique of looking at, you know, transmission microscopy is very common and is good. However, there are two methods of which you can make something fluoresce. One is you tag it with something which is fluorescent. This happens to be fluorescein, which is, you know, very common. And it generally has a lone electron which can move around. For those of you who are interested, the light comes in, it's wiggling like this, the electron therefore goes like this, so that's a dipole moment, and the dipole moment leads to radiation. Okay? Now, so let's be a little bit more quantitative about it. This is the ground state, and general things are sitting up there. You come in with a photon, the excitation. If the photon is about equal to the difference in energy between the ground state and the excited singlet state, it will get absorbed. It then will give up some of its energy in like a picosecond, give it up such that it's in the lowest vibrational state of the excited singlet state. Then it stays at the excited singlet state for a long time, long being relative. That is, it's much longer than this picosecond. In fact, it tends to be in nanoseconds. Then at that point, it has a chance to come down and fluoresce, the emission of a photon. Or there's some probability that actually it will not fluoresce, non-radiatively come back down. Essentially, it's by knocking into a bunch of water molecules. And then it comes down to any of these excited singlet states near the ground state. And then at this point, it thermally relaxes with picosecond time scale and comes back down. So tell me, where is the Stokes shift in this? Okay, go talk about it for 45 seconds.
So it's absorbing one wavelength.
That makes sense. Yeah.
So I think it would be the difference.
Would it be the
spatial? I think the absorption of the fresh one and the difference is the fluorescence. So also, yeah, so the bar is the actual core.
What energy level is this? Is this wavelength? Is this energy? What is that wavelength? Go ahead, keep talking.
Is that your
So you gather counter or items before I go across.
Do you have it? Okay, so I hear a lot of good talking going on. So give me an idea. Doesn't matter if it's right or if it's wrong. Yes, go ahead, Sarab.
So stroke shift would be the change in the wavelength from limited to limited to the incident light.
Okay.
The reason for example, when we incidental light, it will go from ground state to the higher state. But in higher state, there are a lot of vibrational levels.
Good.
So it automatically relaxes to the lowest vibrational level. Yeah.
Yep.
It might not have gone to the lowest in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
It might have gone to the higher vibrational state.
Yep.
Yeah. So it relaxes to the lowest. And then it comes back.
Okay.
So there is a difference in wavelength, which is emitted, and that should be the stroke shift.
Okay, so you're saying that the stroke shift is a matter of the difference in energy between here and here.
And also, it depends on where it comes back.
Good. It depends on where it comes back. Between here and here, also, if it comes back to here, it's then between here and here. That's right. This, what is this axis? Energy. So it comes in with high energy, which is short wavelength, and then emits at a somewhat longer wavelength. And that's these two factors, you add up, they're the energy difference. And if you say it in terms of wavelength, it's the wavelength difference. And that's the stroke shift. Okay, so yes.
So if the fluorescence or if the absorption level was, say, exactly at the lowest possible ground state,
yep.
So it didn't go down anywhere together.
Right.
And then the fluorescence went all the way down to the absolute lowest one, and the stroke shift would be zero.
Yes.
So
that is correct. And there is a certain amount of that it does happen. But in reality, is in fact, almost all have some value. Okay, so let's do just a little bit of the math. And so from here, it can K radiative, K being the rate, or it can do another K, a non-radiative rate. And the total rate is just the non-radiative plus the radiative. Okay? Yes.
What do you mean by rate? Like what does rate have to do with
it? It doesn't have to do with the wavelength. The question is when it gets up here, how much is going to fluoresce versus non-fluoresce? Some molecules, as I mentioned, are really good at fluorescing. Others are really crappy. So this is a matter of quantifying how good of a fluorophore it is. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Okay, the lifetime of this thing, let's say you put in a pulse, and then you look for another pulse, which the other pulse meaning the emission. So So it'll come up here, and then it will take a certain amount of time. The lifetime will be equal to 1 over the total rate. Turns out, depends on both of these. The quantum yield, that is, given that it's absorbed, a photon up here, what is the probability that it will actually emit a photon? The probability is the k radiative divided by all of the processes going down, that is the k non-radiative plus the k radiative. So, let's say what is the quantum yield vary between what and what? If you have a really good fluorophore, it's just perfect. Every time you excite it, it then fluoresces, right? That's the one. The quantum yield is one. So what does that mean about the K radiative and the K non-radiative, the rates? What's that?
Yeah. Whatever you have is radiative.
That's right. It comes up here, loses a little bit of energy, and then from here, it goes down always by emitting radiation, radiative rate. Okay? So this is zero, K radiative over K radiative is one. Now, so what happens if the K radiative increases for some reason? That yes?
It gets closer to one.
The quantum yield goes up. What happens if K non-radiative goes up? That is, it goes here. It's deciding, you know, going to fall down by collision or something with water molecules, or going to radiate. What's that? The quantum yield goes down. And what happens for non-fluorescing molecules? That most, you excite it, goes down here, and most molecules are not fluorescent, and so that they come down here by not fluorescing, that is, not giving up any photons. So what happens for a non-fluorescent molecule? What are the relative sizes of these? That's right. That's basically it. Okay. Okay, this is basically just summarizing what we've done. In general, to make something fluorescent, as I said, you want to add a fluorophore, a fluorescent molecule, to it. For example, give me an example where you want to be able to see something fluorescing, and why would you want to do it? Good. 30 seconds to discuss it. Because this is one of the interesting things. We've given an example of a practical use of this. Yeah.
as long as the last
you can make it bond to something.
Oh, hey,
it's how they like basically attract like
Do you have an example?
Yeah.
We use like fluorescence and DNA to stuff, right? Like to see if we want to see a particular gene.
Exactly.
Also, it's made out of six cyclohexavalent, so it's like going to make it.
So, like, a lot of the questions I wind up writing, like,
okay. So, give me an example where you want to see something, and in general, you use fluorescence for it, and why do you use fluorescence? Come on. Look, I know several of you know the answers or an answer. Yes. DNA sequencing. Good. Good. How does fluorescence come in there? Right. So, for example, you know, you have four nucleotides. You use four different fluorescing molecules, different colors, and then one comes through, and that means A. And then another comes through, that means T. And then another comes through, that means C. Or that's enough. Okay. So that's a situation where we're adding an external fluorophore to the DNA. There is another method. That is, you add a fluorescent dye. Sorry, let me take that back. You add a fluorescent protein. Most proteins, as you know, are not fluorescing. I mean, we're made largely of proteins, and you know, if we shut off the light, do I glow? No, I don't. However, it turns out that there are some fluorescent proteins. If you look at jellyfish, this cute guy, just hold on a second. Jellyfish, it turns out, has anybody ever seen it? They're actually fluorescent. That is, if you go to the ocean and at night, you can see them actually light up. Who has actually seen it? You got one, got two, three. Wow. I mean, you have to move out of Illinois.
Do they fluoresce in different colors or just like only green?
Ah, the question is what color do they...
I remember I've seen like purple.
In fact, there are different jellyfishes and different coral that emit at different wavelengths. And I'll actually show that to you. Okay, so what they've done is they've taken this fluorescent protein from the jellyfish and extracted it. They've extracted it, and if it's a protein, you know that it came from DNA, right? So in fact, what they've done is they've sequenced it. And now, what they've done is they've taken that sequence of DNA and put it on another protein, like, for example, kinesin. So every time, so you have kinesin with a GFP, so as kinesin was walking along inside my cells, you can see it. And I'm not joking about this. Well, so what they did is they first put it in tobacco. That was okay, but tobacco isn't that great. Then they actually put it in a monkey. And so I mentioned the case of kinesin. This is kinesin. It's 2 feet down here, held together by a coil. So what they decided to do to make GFP, GFP stands for green fluorescent protein. So when you, this object, when you shine blue light at it, it will fluoresce and it's green. And so you can actually see it walking or moving. This is a kinesin walking along what are called microtubules. The microtubules you can't see. And you feed it some ATP and it walks. What is the advantage of using a GFP instead of this external fluorophore? What is the advantage of it? Okay, why don't you go think about it? Okay. So why do people bother with GFP? What do you mean?
Genetically encoded perfect specificity. You have like no ambiguity whether you tag the right thing or wrong thing.
That's right. So I realized that I should have covered this up, and then I figured if I did that now, it would be too obvious. That's right, because you can go into the DNA and manipulate it such that all of the kinesins have a GFP, and none of the others, you know, the myosins, the, you know, whatever, the 100,000 other different proteins, they're not labeled, so you get perfect specificity. Also, it turns out that if you want to label a kinesin or anything else, that you have to get if you want to label it with an external fluorophore, you have to get it somehow to reach the kinesin or whatever. The kinesin is often intracellular. Remember, these things are in a cell. Getting through the cell membrane is very difficult because basically they've had, you know, a few billion years to basically make this, the inside, different than the outside, and it's very difficult to get through it. Okay. And in fact, what they've done is they've made a whole series of GFPs, that is, they're called M-orange, tomato, tangerine, strawberry, cherry, and so forth. They've made these largely by DNA mutagenesis, where they change something a little bit and it changes the absorption in the fluorescent spectrum. So these have been incredibly useful. Why do they have regular organic fluorophores, you know, not proteins? Why don't they use this for everything? Yes?
I imagine it's cheaper to take it from something that's already just making it because it makes it rather than like making it itself, I guess, if that makes sense.
But there's a certain economy of scale. Turns out that that's not actually that big of a deal. What can you imagine? Yeah. The stability, what matters. What is stability? What are you talking about?
One of both are emitting more photons.
Maybe the external fluorophore that you put in, maybe it's really strong. That is, its photostability, it lasts a long time, longer than these guys. It turns out that that is absolutely true. These guys are not that all photostable. That is, remember, you come in, you hit it, then you come in and it emits, then you come in and hit it and emits again. These guys do it about 50,000 times, which may seem like a lot, but it's actually not that much, where an organic fluorophore can typically do 1,000,000 photons. And it turns out that that will make a big difference in terms of your resolution or your accuracy. Okay, which actually brings me to the next thing, where we want to see the ultimate in sensitivity. And first we need to discuss how small an individual molecule actually is. And for now, what I'm going to tell you is that you have an infinitely small object. It turns out that when you image it, you will not get an infinitely small object back. If, for example, if you do geometrical optics, then what do you get? The point source here ends up focusing to another point. But that's not good enough. It's not reality. What happens, in fact, let me show you. Okay. Yep, doesn't work. Okay. Forget it. I'm not going to show you. Okay. Okay. So what happens is, it ends up being a finite size point. A point here will be imaged at looking something like that. With this, if you look as a function of space, and this is photon numbers, you get a really intense right in the middle, and then you get, this is called an airy function, over like this. And it turns out that D, the diameter, is equal to lambda, that is the emission, divided by 2, divided by the numerical aperture, where the numerical aperture is lambda over 2 times n, which is the index of refraction, 1 if it's vacuum, 1.4 if it's a little oil, times the sine of theta over here. Okay? And this happens to be the actual image. Okay. Let me explain a little bit why this is. If you look at A0, you know, right here in the middle of this guy, the light comes in. This guy, the light comes in. Though remember, there's a difference in the object distance. And so the phase of the light, yes? This is the point source. This is the objective.
Right here.
Is it the lens? Can I, Josh, could I have the light? This is your object distance, and this is your image distance, okay? So if you're right here on axis, remember, geometrical optics draws this as just lines and goes perfectly. In reality, it's a wave, so this goes, and this goes, and this goes, right? So when you're right here on axis, all of these wavelengths of light add up. They constructively interfere. And so right on axis, you get the maximum signal. But by the way, these are shown in different colors, but in fact, it's one color. It's the same color. Now, what you do is you want to look over here. How much will the intensity be? Well, in fact, the intensity of this will be the intensity of these three positions. And in general, this guy happens to go a little bit farther, and this guy is a little bit closer, and this is still closer. So in general, you'll get some sort of interference effect. And at one point, so you get interference effects, so you start getting less and less intensity. In fact, it goes to zero, and then it actually starts to increase again. Okay, and so the bottom line is it looks like 1/2 times the numerical aperture. And if you don't believe it, you can go to Germany and look at this guy's tombstone. His name is Abbey, and he was the original one who came across this. And on his tombstone, you have D equals lambda over 2n times sine. Well, here he's talking about it being alpha. And if you want to think about practical matters, think about how much money you can make off of this. Turns out that he was the founder of Carl Zeiss Incorporated, which is one of the biggest manufacturers of microscopes. So I don't know what his business acumen was like. He should have made a ton of money. Okay, now, hey, I got about three more minutes. Okay. Let's take the ultimate sensitivity. Let's take a single molecule. We go and image it, and we get something like that looks like this. How is that? This should look like the airy pattern that we just saw, right? It should look like this. Does it? Well, yes, in that we have the big peak. There is a little tiny peak over here and a little tiny peak. In general, it's really hard to see that. So this is what a single molecule looks like in the fluorescent microscope. It has a width over lambda over 2 times the numerical aperture. The numerical aperture is n sine theta. It's about 1. So this is it. The idea is this is like an isolated mountain. Has anybody ever been to Crater Lake? All right. 2, 1, 2. Very good. I've never been there, so take me with you. Have you seen this?
There's no hill in the lake.
There's no hill? Of course there's a hill. You think I'm making this up?
Well, I just want to think of that one.
Josh, did you see this? No.
Go there to look at the lake.
Yeah, but there's an... The point is, there's an isolated mountain. I'm going to have to go here and take a picture of this. Anyways, so you have an isolated mountain, okay? The mountain may be, you know, a half a mile wide. Can you tell where the center is? Yeah, in general, you can tell very well. So the fact that this is lambda over 2 does not tell you that about your accuracy as to where the center is. So let's go back to this. How accurately can you tell where the center of that mountain is? Yes?
Does it depend on the width of the standard deviation kind of type of stuff?
Okay, does it depend on the width and a standard deviation kind of stuff? Well, the kind of stuff part is right. No, that's right. This is the standard deviation. What tells you about how well you can locate the average position of that, or the mean? What's that? Yes, it's related, but come on. Think of your mathematical hat. Got it? How many people have taken what the standard deviation is? Raise your hand. You haven't taken a course that... Oh, wow. Oh, really?
The question was positive, wasn't
it? How many of you have taken what the standard deviation is? How many have not? Oh, okay. You know what that means? Homework. Anyways, this width is the standard deviation. Yes. What? Okay. 10:30. No. I mean, we started at. All right. You interrupted everything. And go take your break. 2 minutes. 11:29 or 10:29. Okay.
The lake is very pretty.
You're And as the number of photons hit your eye decreases, it gets harder and harder to tell where they are. So, for example, when the sun is going down, you know, clearly when the sun is completely gone down, you look and you see zero. And so you have no idea. But when the sunset is approaching and you see a little bit, you get some sort of sense. So what you want is not actually the standard deviation, but you want the standard error of the mean. And the SEM, that is standard error of the mean, looks like the standard deviation, this, divided by the square root of n. Or in other words, it looks like 250 nanometers divided by the square root of n. Where n is, in this case, the number of photons hitting it. This data is real data. It was formed, actually, by one of my students. And it turns out that there is about 14,000 photons that make this up. So let's just make it 10,000. So that means the standard deviation is like 250 nanometers divided by the square root of 10,000. What's the square root of 10,000? About 100. So 250 divided by 100 is 2.5 nanometers. You think about it, that's pretty amazing. What it says is that if this center were to move even just a tiny fraction of a width over here, you could tell it. You could know. So for example, let's attach this to a kinesin. Let's say you attach it to the head of kinesin, and then you feed it some ATP. And, you know, you want to see it walk. Kinesin walks with about 8.3 nanometers per ATP, and then 8.3 nanometers, and then 8.3 nanometers. So 8.3 nanometers is significantly bigger than you can determine. So that means you should be able to take kinesin, label it on its head, feed it some ATP, and you should see the thing walk. And you can actually determine it. And that's exactly what we did. That is, via optical traps, remember, they have nanometer resolution. So what they did is they put a big, not fluorescent, but a big plastic bead on it and watched it move, and they found that they got 8.3 nanometers. So now, let's see, can we do it again with fluorescence? And it turns out that there will be many applications of this. Okay, so this is like holy cow. Whiz! Hey, realizing this, it was a holy cow time. Anyways, yes.
So when we calculate standard error of mean, basically like we're trying to figure out the deviation of just the x, y displacement.
That's whatever we're trying to measure. That's correct. That's correct.
And then what does lambda represent? What is the difference between these two deviations?
The lambda over two is essentially the width of your distribution. So the width of the mountain, and just how well can you tell where the center is given the width? Yes?
Is that like the diameter or the radius? Sorry, like, is it from one edge of the mountain to the other, or like from the center?
It's a factor of two, from the diameter to the radius. I'm not actually sure. It turns out the reality is we can actually get it to 1.3 nanometer, half of this, and I think it more or less has to do with the diameter versus the radius. Okay, so let's talk about molecular motors for a little bit, and then we're going to apply them to myosin, to kinesin, to dynein, and so forth. Okay, there are three different families of molecular motors. One is kinesin, a second is myosin, and a third is called dynein. They all pretty much look identical in that they have two legs which bind to roadways. In this case, the roadway for kinesin is it walks on microtubules, a microtubule here, and a microtubule here. It happens to be that kinesin walks one way on the microtubules, and dynein happens to walk the other way. And then there is another class of roadways in the cell called actin, and you have myosin, which walks on actin. And it turns out, well, yes, there are three families. There are many types within the family. Like there's about 30 different myosins, then myosin 1, 2, 3. And then even within that, for example, there's myosin 5, but then there's A, B, C, etc. And they all do something slightly different. But okay, what they all do is they take ATP. There is an ATP binding site in each of these feet. They bind it, then they cleave it off. That gives them some free energy, which they do to take a walk. Okay? So, what we've done is we've invented a technique called Fiona, which is basically the technique that I just talked to you about. Who knows who Fiona actually is? Yeah. Who does not know? All right. 1, 2, 3. That's pretty good. Really? I guess Hollywood hasn't come to Urbana-Champaign. You're looking like confused. Like, who is she?
I feel like I've come to the point.
Yeah. You have. Sort of. So, who can explain to the three people who haven't seen them?
She's a character in a movie that was pretty popular. Came out a while ago. It makes fun of fairy tales and stuff.
What?
Shrek.
Huh? Shrek.
Shrek.
Yeah, Shrek.
Shrek.
Yeah, okay. Anyways. But sometimes she looks very pretty and sometimes she doesn't. And it turns out that her name is an acronym, Fluorescence Imaging with 1 nanometer Accuracy, so that we've gotten essentially like a nanometer accuracy, and then we can take it at various different times. And what we do is we essentially rely on the fact that we can very accurately determine where the center is. And what we do is take, for example, kinesin. We want to label it on the head. In this case, up here. We're going to use what's called a quantum dot, which is an unusually good fluorophore. We've used regular small organic fluorophores. Doesn't matter what they are. It has microtubule here, and we're going to feed it some ATP. So here, let me just say, here's the microtubule, and here is a single kinesin labeled with a quantum dot, and then what? Hold on. Wait, you just... Oh, I can't believe this. Ah. Okay, ready? And this is very exciting. And you can see an individual kinesin moving. And in fact, what you can do is now plot as a function of time the position. And what you find is that it takes a series of discrete steps. In fact, you can plot out the size of the steps here and the number of them. And you can fit it, and you fit it, and it gets 8.4 plus or minus 0.7 nanometers. So that says that the kinesin is moving with 8.4 nanometers for each ATP. So that's a fantastic resolution, and it's in very much in agreement with what they did in optical traps. And so, aren't you guys just thrilled by it? I can tell, you know, that you want to stay, like, you don't care the fact that in 7 minutes you need to go. You're like, you just want to clap, don't you?
Yeah.
There we go. That's true. Okay, I want to get to one other aspect. Yes.
Does the kinesin work around the microtubule?
Does the kinesin work around the microtubule? The answer is no. It turns out that this distance is 8.3 nanometers, and so it tends to just go on one side. Okay, so now, the other question that I wanted to ask, and this it cannot be answered by optical traps, is how is the thing walking? Remember, I put it on the head, and I watched it move 8.3 nanometers, but maybe it's actually walking like this. That is, it's walking sort of like a caterpillar. In that case, 8.3 nanometers, and then 8.3 nanometers, then 8.3 nanometers. You'd always see 8.3 nanometers. In contrast to walking, where, tell me how, imagine that you put a fluorophore on the foot. And in that case, when the top, the head goes 8.3 nanometers, this goes 16.6 nanometers, and then zero, and then 16.6 nanometers. So we should be able to tell which it is. And I'm sure this is not going to work. And it doesn't. Hold on. I know. Don't even think of leaving. Yeah, you can talk all you want right now, but because it's really exciting. What?
Oh man, I'm so hyped.
Oh man. Aha. Ah. Okay. I know. Okay. Hold on to your hats because this is really exciting. Okay. So here we're doing this again, though this case it's labeled on the foot. And you do the same thing. This is kinesin walking. And how much is it walking? In this case, it's about 16 nanometers. In fact, you do a distribution, and you get 16.3 nanometers, just what you'd expect for literally the thing is walking. So it really walks. And not only that, okay, this will be the last thing I promise. Not only that, but think about it takes 16.3 nanometers, and then what happens in the next step? It's zero. And so it goes 16.6, zero, 16.6. And in fact, we can actually see this hidden step over here. And I'll give it to you as homework. Because, well, hey, you know, you guys, you gotta leave, right? Okay, so I'm just forced to give it to you as homework. All right.